The next question we should be asking is whether the test is reliable. If we wanted to measure something, for example, the height of this person, we could use a tape measure like this. According to this tape measure, her height is about 170 centimetres. Then if we wanted to measure her height again, just to be sure, we get the tape measure out again. But it turns out the tape measure is actually all wobbly and difficult to use, and because I'm stingy and bought a really cheap one. So this time we get a different measurement that is actually more than our first measurement, about 180 centimetres. Now, because the measurement changed from the first time we measured to the second time, we would say that our tape measure is not reliable. Reliability is the extent to which a measure gives you consistent measures on repeated measurements. So, with regard to tests, reliability measures the extent to which the test yields consistent scores for individuals. Now, when it comes to an intelligence test, we can't evaluate its reliability by just looking at it to see whether or not it wobbles all over the place like my cheap tape measure. There are different techniques we could use to evaluate the reliability of tests. These include alternate forms reliability, split half reliability, and test-retest reliability. Alternate forms reliability involves the evaluation of two different versions of the same test. The scores from the two tests are then compared to see if the test is actually reliable. For example, I'd like you to imagine that my research team has been awarded $1 million to develop an intelligence test for university students. We used half of that money to develop one version of the test and developed a second version of the test with the other half of the money. To test the reliability of our newly developed intelligence tests, we then asked a large sample of university students to complete both version 1 and version 2 of the test. Then we compared students' performance on version 1 of the test to version 2. We graphed it like this. Here, someone has scored about a 10 on version 1 of the test and about a 10 on version 2. This person here scored just under 40 on version 1 and about 40 on version 2. This person here scored about 70 on version 1 and about a 70 on version 2. What do you notice there? Do you notice a positive correlation between the scores from version 1 of the test and scores from version 2? As scores on one go up, they go up on the other. You notice that they're quite closely clustered together on that diagonal. There's not a lot of error or variation in where the scores fall. They generally increase on both at the same rate. If you eyeball that, that's probably a correlation of at least 0.8. That's a pretty good correlation. That would tell us our measure is reliable because the two versions of the test are effectively producing the same result. Split half reliability also involves the evaluation of two tests. However, sometimes, maybe due to money or time constraints, it might not be possible for researchers to develop two versions of the test. So when this happens, what we can do is split one test into two tests. From here, we can do what we did before, which was asking a large number of university students to complete a single test, and then compare their performance on the first half of the test and their performance on the second half of the test. We can graph it, and it looks exactly the same. It's the same data because conceptually it's exactly the same idea. All we're doing here is evaluating whether or not the students are responding similarly between the first half of the test and the second half. We can do the correlation again, and it's about 0.8. From this, we can conclude that this test is reliable. Is this a good way to do it? Do you see any problems with just cutting one test in half as a way to evaluate test reliability?